You're listening to the Naked Bible Podcast. To support this podcast, visit nakedbiblepodcast.com and click on the support link in the upper right-hand corner. If you're new to the podcast and Dr. Heiser's approach to the Bible, click on New Start Here at nakedbiblepodcast.com.
Welcome to the Naked Bible Podcast, episode 95, David Burnett, the resurrection and the death of the gods. I'm your layman, Trey Strickland, and he's the scholar, Dr. Michael Heiser. Hey, Mike, how are you?
Very good. We're real happy to have David Burnett back. Dave, how are you doing?
Good. How are you guys?
Yeah, very good. Good to hear your voice, and thanks for taking the time to do this again with us.
Trey, you were going to say something. Well, by the name of the title, Resurrection and the Death of the Gods, I'm excited about this episode. So.
Yeah, it's a good title. I can hardly wait to hear. We all want to see the gods get what they deserve, you know? Hey, Dave, why don't you, for those who may not have heard you before, David has been on the podcast before, and he pastors a church in Arthur City, Texas. So, Dave, if you could give listeners a bit of an update, you know, since you were on the last time, you know, what's been going on with the church, with you? I mean, how are things?
Yeah, things are pretty good. The church is going pretty well. We've taken a break from Genesis and been going through some different passages, and I think things are going well there. And I've been continuing my research, and just recently presented a paper 2 weeks ago at the Southwest Commission on Religious Studies, which is the regional meeting for the Society of Biblical Literature and the American Academy of Religion. And I presented a paper there called A Neglected Deuteronomic Scriptural Matrix for the Nature of the Resurrection Body in 1 Corinthians 15:39 through 42. So this is an atrociously long title, I recognize. So, but the simple version is I'm challenging kind of the consensus in scholarship of what the background is to this list of creatures that Paul brings up in 1 Corinthians 15 in his conversation about the nature of the resurrection body.
So you're going to give us this is going to be the gist of what you're going to give us in this episode in non-academese.
Yes, that's right. I'll boil it down and make it hopefully easy to understand.
Yeah, well, scholars like those long, highfalutin titles. You know, we used to, I don't know if you remember this, but we used to give these little awards. You know, I had a small group of friends every year at ETS. You know, we'd give these invisible kind of after the evening after the day's events awards at ETS for who had the most obtuse paper title. You know, who had the funniest paper title. So your paper title would, you'd probably get one for obtuse. You'd get a nomination for that.
Fair enough.
Yeah, we like those long, hard to figure out titles. So, well, I'm glad you're doing well. Now you've gotten a paper accepted for the national. Is it this one or is it a different one?
Yeah, it's this one.
Okay,
yeah,
so national meeting in November.
Mm-hmm, in San Antonio. So I'll actually be this one's going to be very interesting. I'm actually participating in a seminar in 1 Corinthians 15 entitled Death, Resurrection, and Transformation in Scripture in 1 Corinthians 15. And so it's I think Roy Champa, Craig Keener, Linda Belleville, Raymond Collins, some other David Litva, who we've spoke about before. Sure. We're all in this seminar together, so it's gonna be really great. I'm gonna submit the paper ahead of time, and there'll be formal responses to the paper and open dialogue. So it'll be very similar to what I did in 2014 at SBL, but this one is a little bit more formalized. It's a part of a 2-part seminar on 1 Corinthians 15, so we're the second part. So I'm really excited to be involved in that, and so. The paper that I'll be presenting there is kind of an advanced version of the one I did just a couple of weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And so I'm still doing some more research on that. And hopefully sometimes these seminars turn into edited books. I'm hoping that happens. Mm-hmm. If not, I'll submit it to a journal. So,
yeah. Yeah. Well, that's good. And for those again, who are listening, I bring up the annual meetings, you know, with a good bit of frequency here. I mean, this next one David's talking about is in San Antonio. So it's always the week before Thanksgiving. And if anybody who, you know, anybody lives in the area, I mean, Trey is actually planning on making the trip. We're planning on doing something related to the podcast in San Antonio next year. But anybody who lives in the neighborhood who wants to check out, hey, what happens at these meetings? You know, I offered this at Atlanta last November and had a few people come. You know, we just sort of, you know, walk around and go to papers and, hey, this is what scholars do. And they get a chance to listen to some people, names that they know, a lot of names that they don't know. But, you know, if you're in the area, I'll be putting more information about it on the blog, you know, as the time approaches, you know, toward November.
And David, I'll be your plant. So if you have any questions you want me to ask you, I'll make you look good. If you just want to give me your questions beforehand, I'll make you look good.
Well, I appreciate that, but I try to keep it as honest as possible.
Well, that's no fun.
Yeah, well, you know.
Well, you know, somebody has to be boring, I guess. You know, it's just that's the way it is. Hey, why don't you jump in now? We can just get started, and you jump in where you want to jump in, and Trey and I will. With everybody else, we'll listen and, you know, have a conversation where we need to, and the rest of the time is essentially yours.
All right. Well, like I said, the premise of my paper is 1 Corinthians 15 is, as we all know, kind of the central text for resurrection, not just in Paul, but in the New Testament, really. I mean, it's the only very clear, relatively clear passage we have on that actually goes into detail, not only of kind of the narrative of what happens in resurrection, but goes even into the nature of the resurrection body itself. And so this, that's extremely significant in 1 Corinthians 15, because it's often used in kind of apologetic conversations about the proof of the resurrection and look at all the witnesses and this kind of thing. But that's not really what I'm tackling here. What I'm tackling here is the conversation that Paul has on the actual nature of the resurrection body. And the passage is coming from verse 35 through 42 in 1 Corinthians 15. And I'll just read that passage. And actually, I probably want to read down to verse 50 because it's all one solid unit here. So I'll read it in English and we'll get into it. It's, Paul says, "But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? You foolish person, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and each kind of seed its own body. For not all flesh is the same, but there is one kind for humans, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. There are heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is of one kind, and the earthly another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for star differs from star in glory. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also those who are of heaven. Just as we have been born the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. So I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable." So that's the passage. It's a pretty long passage, but and it focuses on this metaphor for the resurrection of the sowing of the seed and the seed going into the ground and coming up different, the old body versus the new body in the resurrection. And right in the center of that conversation, we have this interesting list of creatures, this comparison between earthly bodies, like terrestrial bodies that are on the earth, and then celestial bodies. And Paul uses language of flesh to describe the first group, and then he uses the language of glory to describe the second group. And the traditional background for this list, since obviously Paul's drawing on Adam language there, traditionally all scholars have said, oh, well, this is clearly Genesis 1 and 2 language. You know, you have the created animals, and you have the sun, moon, stars, and then you have a mention of Adam. And there's even the mention of seed and their types in the creation story in Genesis 1. So clearly this is drawing on Genesis 1 and 2, for sure. And so that's the consensus of the background of this creature list here in 1 Corinthians 15, 39 through 42. But there are some problems with this view. The actual list of the creatures, if Paul is drawing on Genesis 1, 11 through 28, which is the traditional background that's listed for this, they don't actually follow the same order. They're in reverse. It's backwards. And not only do they not follow the same order, but it actually doesn't follow the same pattern of naming the creatures either. So there's this assumed consensus in the secondary literature that doesn't see any need for any alternate model. And so they're overlooking a possible background that could actually provide a more robust reading of the passage in its wider literary and narrative context. And so when you actually see the list of creatures here, Paul starts with, in verse 39, with the flesh, those are of flesh. And he says, man, domestic animals, birds, and fish. Now, this is the backwards order from Genesis 1, and there's verses in between them. But there is a list that follows the same order, and it's not in Genesis 1. It's actually found in Deuteronomy 4, because Paul goes through, says man, animals, birds, and fish, and then he goes, when he gets to the celestial bodies, because he separates them, the earthly from the celestial, and he says sun, moon, stars. There is actually an order that – there's actually a text that follows that same order, Deuteronomy 4. Mm. And so in Deuteronomy 4, specifically the passage I'm drawing on is verse 15 through 19. And this text – or 15 through 20 actually. And in this text, this is the
– just this is for those, yeah, for those who don't recall, maybe this is a divine counsel passage. You know, Deuteronomy 32 worldview, and this is the Deuteronomy 4 passage for it.
Yeah, so what I meant in this longer title, Deuteronomic Scriptural Matrix, all I mean is there's a group of texts throughout Deuteronomy that all refer to these celestial powers as the gods or angels of nations, and Deuteronomy 4 is one of these passages. And Deuteronomy 4 is actually incredibly important because it's talking about – the context is not to make any graven images. So this is an aniconic passage. This is a passage about idolatry and not worshiping the powers of the gods. And it actually narrates, it has this list of creatures and then gives the reason for it, because Israel was exodus. They were elected and chosen from out the nations, and they're not given to these powers. So I want to read this text because it's very surprising for many who haven't considered it as a background for 1 Corinthians 15, but it actually follows the same list of creatures. I'll read it. It says, closely guard your souls, because you did not see a likeness on the day that the Lord spoke to you at Horeb in the mountain from the midst of the fire. Do not act lawlessly and make for yourselves a carved likeness of any image, a likeness of male or female, a likeness of any animal that's on the earth, a likeness of any winged bird that flies under the heaven, a likeness of any reptile that creeps on the ground, and a likeness of any fish that is in the water under the earth. So here we see that there's the same list in the same order of creatures in the earthly as Paul lists here. Now, there is the reptile included in Deuteronomy 4 passage, but that Paul does not include. And so someone might say, well, yeah, reptiles in that list. It's not in Paul's. But reptiles are in the list in Genesis 1 as well. So that's not a category to dismiss this.
Yeah, it's not an impediment either way.
Right. Either way, these reptiles are listed in Genesis 1 and in the Deuteronomy 4 passage. But Paul lists them in the same order. And Deuteronomy also has this division between the earthly creatures and the celestial. Because right after he lists those creatures, Deuteronomy says, "And do not lift up your eyes to heaven and see the sun, the moon, and the stars." And the author of Deuteronomy calls them all the hosts of heaven. "And be drawn away and worship them and serve them, those which the Lord your God has allotted to all the nations under the whole heaven. But God has taken you and brought you out of the iron furnace, out of Egypt, to become for him an allotted people, as in this day." So this is very interesting, the conglomeration of language here in Deuteronomy 4, the language that's used in this list, because the premise to not make any graven images of any of these creatures, the fleshly creatures, was mm-hmm. you didn't see his likeness. And it's the Greek term here is omoioma. Now, Paul uses this term elsewhere. Paul uses this term of Christ when he takes on the likeness of sinful flesh. So the body itself is referred to in this language. So the likeness is of these fleshly creatures. So when Paul's listing the differentiation of these bodies, the earthly and the celestial, it follows that not only the same pattern in Deuteronomy 4, but this second group in Deuteronomy 4, the sun, moon, stars, are called the host of heaven that were allotted to all the nations. And so this is part of the Deuteronomy 32 worldview. Elsewhere, you know, in Deuteronomy 17, 3, you have the language to come back up of this other gods language, where it says, "If there is found in your midst any of your towns, which the Lord your God is giving you, a man or woman who does what is evil in the sight of the Lord your God by transgressing his covenant and has gone and served other gods and worshiped them, whether the sun, the moon, or any of the host of heaven, which I have forbidden." So in Deuteronomy 17, you already have this type of language again, repeating the same type of language from Deuteronomy 4. Sun, moon, and host of heaven is kind of just a secondary for sun, moon, and stars. And they're called the other gods. And so later in Deuteronomy 29, the language pops back up of allotment in 29:26. "And they went and served other gods and worshiped them, gods whom they had not known, whom he had not allotted to them." So again, we're drawing on that allotted language from 4. And of course, it climaxes in the Song of Moses and Deuteronomy 32:8-9 that your listeners are well aware of, with the allotment of the sons of God or angels of God over the nations. So what we're having here is, if this list is the list that Paul's drawing on, why is he drawing on this list instead of Genesis? Because this passage, we might forget what it's actually about. Resurrection isn't just about, hey, there's a miracle, you get to live eternally and get back up out of the grave. Mm-hmm. It's an actual change of nature here. And that these celestial bodies are not just kind of inanimate objects for Paul that he's listing. In the Jewish cosmology, in the Jewish view of the cosmic order, these creatures are actual creatures. These are beings. And not just beings or creatures, but specifically that language of sun, moon, stars is used for the gods of the nations, for the ones who would rule over the ethne or the nations.
You know, what's really interesting, I mean, while you were going through that, I ran a quick search here on the for the herpetu, you know, the quote-unquote reptile, or other translations would just have quadruped, the thing that's omitted. And one of the references is Romans 1, and it has the other elements there, man, birds, animals, you know, with them. And that's clearly idolatry. You know,
clearly.
It's actually in the verse that talks about exchanging, you know, the worship of the creator for the created thing, you know, making themselves images and so on and so forth. So, yeah, that's a pretty clear... The idolatry is a pretty clear element here.
Yeah, and it's amazing because why scholars wouldn't recognize this list, it is kind of boggling my mind, because Paul in 1 Corinthians has already drawn on this list. He's already drawn on the Deuteronomy language in earlier in 1 Corinthians, because
chapter 10.
Yeah, and 8 through 12 is dealing with the idolatry issues. Mm-hmm. And there even he even quotes from Deuteronomy 4. For example, in the famous Christology passage in 1 Corinthians 8, 5 and 6, when he says, "Therefore, as to eating food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, that is, there is no God but one," which is coming from Deuteronomy 4, 35 and 39. Mm-hmm. And he says, "For although there may be so-called gods in heaven and earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, and one Lord." You know the passage. So mm-hmm. what's interesting there is that's the passage of election from Deuteronomy. That for us, you know, we've been exodus out. We've been drawn out of Egypt, which has their own gods allotted to them. Mm-hmm. And we have one Father, one God. It's Yahweh, the God of Israel. And so the same kind of complex of language he's already drawing on in 1 Corinthians and continues to draw on it. And it's very interesting. But back to the Deuteronomy 4 passage, Paul's wouldn't be the only one in Second Temple Judaism at his actual time to mm-hmm. use Deuteronomy 4 this way, to talk about these celestial bodies as actual rulers over the cosmos. Matter of fact, and we've talked about this before, Mike, but Philo actually uses this same exact Deuteronomy 4 passage when he's describing the Jewish view of the cosmos. When he describes the Jewish view of the cosmos and how the cosmos is ordered and set up, the passage is from Special Laws 1, 13, and 19. I'm going to read that to you because this is fascinating. And some people just have never made these connections. So the passage reads like this. Philo says, "Some have supposed that the sun and moon and other stars were gods with absolute powers." And the term here is autokratoras, meaning they're just, they have powers in and of themselves, you know, and ascribe to them the causation of all events. But Moses held that the cosmos, this is the term in Greek for world that Paul uses all the time, the cosmos was created and is in the sense the greatest of commonwealths, having rulers. And now his term for rulers here is archontas and excusa. This is the term that Paul uses, the terms that Paul uses for the powers and the principalities.
Yeah.
Same terms. So Philo's talking about the cosmos as this great government, saying it has rulers, these rulers, and it has subjects. Now, for the rulers, the archontas, all the celestial bodies, the oronu pantas, all the celestial bodies, he says, fixed or wandering. For subjects, such beings as exist below the moon, in the air or on the earth. So you see the separation here, just like Deuteronomy 4 sets out. Right, you have the celestial bodies that rule everything under the moon, which is air on the earth. So we got birds and all the creatures
under the dome and all that kind of stuff. It's still part of the world as we know it.
Now he goes on.
We'd experience it.
Yeah, he goes on and says the said rulers, however, in his view, have not unconditional powers, but they are rulers or lieutenants of the one Father of all, and it's by copying the example of his government, exercised according to justice and law, deacon. So this is used for righteousness all the time in the New Testament, over all created beings, that they acquit themselves aright. But to those who do not descry the charioteer mounted above, attribute the causation of all events in the cosmos to the team that draw the chariot, as though they were the sole agents. So he's picking on the Greeks here, you know? He's like, look, these dumb Greeks, They're attributing all the works of the creation to these little secondary rulers, the ones who actually draw the chariot of the big boss guy on the chariot.
Yeah. So they're worshiping the flunkies. Yeah.
Yeah. He's making fun of them. He goes on to say, from this ignorance, now this is where it gets interesting. Look at the passage he quotes here. He says, from this ignorance, our most holy lawgiver would convert them to knowledge with these words, quote, "Do not, when thou seest the sun, moon, and stars, and all the hosts of heaven, go astray and worship them." Deuteronomy 4:19.
Yep, yep.
Quotes the same passage. And he says, well, indeedly and aptly does he call the acceptance of the heavenly bodies as gods going astray and wandering. And then later he says, the other stars in accordance with their sympathetic affinity to things on Earth, acting and working in a thousand ways to preserve the all, have wandered infinitely far in supposing that they alone are gods. So all the gods, which sense descries in heaven, must not suppose to possess absolute power, but to have received the rank of subordinate rulers, naturally liable to correction, though in virtue of their excellence, never destined to undergo it. So in Philo's mind...
Isn't that really interesting, you know, how Philo, a Jew, would use Deuteronomy 4 essentially for evangelism? You know, that you guys need to quit, you know, worshiping the lesser ones and turn your attention to the real, you know, to the true God, the one that actually does run everything. You know, it's just kind of interesting.
Yeah, so well, that's a very good point, because what's going on here is he himself is a Jew. So in his mind, he's one of these chosen people. Mm-hmm. And so he's not under those powers. But in his mind, all the other nations are. Because mm-hmm. and he even calls them the celestial bodies themselves are the archontas and the excusa, the rulers and principalities. Now, this is the exact same language Paul uses in 1 Corinthians 15. He calls them the celestial bodies, same terms that Philo's using, and he even calls them earlier in 1 Corinthians the rulers, principalities, and powers. We're going to come back to that, but there's something about Philo here that's very interesting. In this passage, he thinks that these powers are fine. He's like, all the gods that describes in heaven, they don't possess absolute powers, but they're subordinate rulers, and they are naturally liable to correction, but though in virtue of their excellence, they're never destined to undergo it. So he's not an apocalypticist. Mm-hmm. Philo doesn't think there's anything wrong with these gods per se. He just thinks Greeks are stupid to worship them. He's like, you should worship the one father of all, you know. Why are you attributing all things to these secondary powers? He doesn't really have a problem with them, though, as much. Now, Philo is very Platonic, though. He's very Platonic. He's very involved in Platonic readings of the Old Testament. He has all kinds of allegory that he uses, Platonic philosophy to describe Old Testament texts. And Plato commonly has this – that shares the same kind of a view that you have powers that are ruling over humans because they can't take care of themselves. So a passage that talks about this in Plato is in Plato's Laws in 4.7.13 and in 7.38. There's this conversation that goes on in Plato's Laws, and the Athenian says this when they're describing kind of – the order of the cosmic government. He says, well then, tradition tells us how blissful was the life of men in that age, furnished with everything in abundance and of spontaneous growth. And the cause thereof is said to have been this. Well, so why is everything working so great? Why is everything in like this beautiful cosmic order? He gives you the reason. He says, Cronos, you know, their high god of time, he says he was aware of the fact that no human being, as we have explained, is capable of having irresponsible control of all human affairs without becoming filled with pride and injustice. So, pondering this fact, he then appointed as kings and rulers for our cities, not men, but beings of a race that was nobler and more divine, namely demons. He acted as we now do in the case of sheep and herds of tame animals. We do not set oxen as rulers over oxen or goats over goats, but we who are of a nobler race ourselves rule over them. In like manner, the God, in his love for humanity, set over us at that time the nobler race of demons, who with much comfort to themselves and much to us took charge of us and furnished peace for us, and modesty, and orderliness, and justice, without stint, and thus made the tribes of men free from feud and happy. So now, this is in Plato.
Yeah, which book was that in Plato?
This is in Plato's Laws.
Okay, catch this. This is really interesting. Not long ago, you don't know him, but the audience will. Doug Van Dorn sent me an email with a passage in Plato about this. About the Deuteronomy 32 worldview. And this is at the end of his Critics. And I'll just read you a couple lines from it. He says, This is Plato. In the days of old, the gods had the whole earth distributed among them by allotment. There was no quarreling, for you cannot rightly suppose that the gods did not know what was proper for each of them to have. So, you know, obviously he has the gods deciding this distribution among themselves, as opposed to the biblical version where these sorts of any such arrangement is at the behest, you know, of the Most High, you know, to use biblical language.
Right.
Plato says, knowing this, that they should seek to procure for themselves by contention that which more properly belonged to others. They, all of them, by just apportionment, obtained what they wanted and peopled their own districts. And when they had peopled them, they tended us, their nurslings and possessions, as shepherds tend their flocks, excepting only that they did not use blows or bodily force as shepherds do, but governed us like pilots from the stern of a vessel, which is an easy way of guiding animals, holding our souls by the rudder of persuasion according to their own pleasure. Thus they did guide all mortal creatures. Different gods had their allotments in different places, which they set in order. I mean, that is, again,
that's it.
Absent of the Most High, again, which is obviously really important for biblical theology, that's the same idea.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so when Paul, even when Paul, I mean, he's writing to the Corinthians, he doesn't have to like educate them. Well, you got to get your Jewish theology in your heads and then I can talk to you people. I mean, he can address them on the same basis because this idea was very familiar. You know, what's missing, of course, again, is again, the biblical theological element of the Most High and, of course, the Most High and the Incarnation and all that kind of stuff. But you can see the framework for them is already there, even as Gentiles.
Yeah, absolutely. And Philo, it's interesting because, you know, Plato's writing hundreds of years before Philo. And when Philo's a student of these kinds of worldviews, he sees it's very congenial. This is what we've talked about in our scriptures. You know, this is, and he uses Deuteronomy 4 to describe that setup of the cosmos.
Mm-hmm.
That this is when, and he even uses the language from the Septuagint of God's creation, but he likens it to the election of Israel, because Deuteronomy 4 is the grounds for not worshiping those beings is the election of Israel, is having them taken out from the power, so they are not under them.
Yeah, and that's perfect with the whole disinheritance or divorce idea that happens in, you know, back at Babel, Deuteronomy 32. I'm distancing myself from you, and I'm going to elect Israel. I'm going to call Abraham.
Yeah, and that the Abraham part is super important here, because the language here in Deuteronomy 4, the same list of powers here, the grounds to not worship those beings is because they were allotted to the ethne. They're allotted to the nations. They're not one of them anymore. They've come out from under them. It's very interesting. And so where the Greeks can talk about them as demons. Because it's not all the time. We think that's talked about all the time in the New Testament, just demon, demon, demon. But it's very specific passages that mention them. Mm-hmm. Because in 1 Corinthians, Paul does mention these demons in the same aniconic passages, in the against idolatry passages. Earlier in 1 Corinthians 10, 20 verse 21, Paul says, "No, I imply that what the ethne, the nations, sacrifice, they offer to demonies, the demons, and not to God. I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink."
It's Deuteronomy 30.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Deuteronomy 32:17. That's the passage.
There it is. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord, table of demons. So what Paul's envisioning here is they've actually come out from under them. They're not actually under their rule anymore. And you see this pop up, this language. People read over this language and they're not catching the narrative. There's a election narrative going on here where Paul talks later in 1 Corinthians 12:2. He says, "You know that when you were ethne, when you were nations, you were led astray to mute idols. However, you were led." You see the language there? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He's drawing on the idolatry section still from this idea from Deuteronomy 4, that you were under them and that made you ethne, right? Because those nations, they have those celestial powers all allotted to them, right? So you were going after those idols however you were led to do so. You know, it's like you were led into doing that by the powers in Paul's mind. So he calls them demons, just like the Greeks do. So this whole idea is you were ethne, but you've been taken out from under them. Now, a lot of Paul scholars in recent scholarship, you know as well as I do, Mike, that this debate over identity in Paul, are they Jews? Is it a new thing called Christianity? Are they just practicing Judaism? These debates are so caught up in kind of the ethnic identity and modern Jewish Christian relations conversations that they sometimes become ahistorical at times. And, you know, and it's kind of straying away from the language that Paul's using, because Paul, when he's saying that you were pagans, you were nations or ethne, you were Gentiles, it's not meaning it's like all of a sudden you're becoming a Jew, you know, and so you're a Jew.
It's a theological category, not an ethnic category.
Exactly. It's theological. They were under these demons. They were under these powers. But now, all the way back to 1 Corinthians 8, where the conversation began, we don't have those other gods anymore. We have one God. It's Yahweh. So they picture themselves, whatever's happened, as a new exodus, a new election, which this is an Old Testament concept, right? I mean, the idea of election is exodus in the Old Testament. Take the language with Abraham, right? When Abraham's chosen out of the 70 nations, that's the Deuteronomy 32 worldview right there in Genesis 10 and 11. He's taken out. He's not one of the 70. Israel or Jacob is not listed in the table of nations because they're not one of them. They're not one of the ethne. They're taken out from them. And by the time you get to Genesis 15 and you have the promise of star-like seed, the thing we talked about in my last interview, what does he tell Moses, or what does he tell Abraham right after that vision of the star-like seed? He tells him that I delivered you, Abraham, out of Ur of the Chaldeans. I've purchased you. I've delivered you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to inherit. And that phrase in the Hebrew is kind of a stock phrase used all throughout Torah for the Exodus, but you just change Ur of the Chaldeans for Egypt. You know, I am the God that delivered you out of Egypt to give you this land to inherit. So he sees election as an exodus from under the powers. You know, you were under the powers. I elect you. I choose you out from the 70 who I had allotted powers over, and you're mine. You're my allotted inheritance.
It makes sense, you know, that the Exodus event, you know, and the way that that's written about would, you know, would draw upon the earlier language of Abraham for that reason. Because again, look at the way the whole Exodus is set. You know, the Passover, this night I will have victory over the gods of Egypt. You know, so it's this release, you know, from being under the dominion, not just of Egyptians, because that's the way we all think of the Exodus, you know, the physical bondage and slavery. But the plagues are actually directed in the Passover, you know, the last plague there specifically. Even though it's the death of the firstborn, that's where you get this language, this night I will have victory over the gods of Egypt. You know, then you get the song of Moses in Exodus 15, you know, who is like you among the Elim?
Yes.
You know, I mean, it's very consistent, you know, to have this thinking that, okay, just as I rescued Abraham, now I need to rescue, you know, the children of Abraham, because they're in Egypt, they're in bondage, I've heard their cries and so on and so forth. But you know, the process of doing that is a release from bondage of the other gods.
That's it. And those plagues are also a judgment of those gods, right? Because so that's really important. And where you get now, so the real question would become, well, then how is this all tied to resurrection? Mm-hmm. But when we're thinking of resurrection with 1 Corinthians 15, we're not importing the narrative view of resurrection that actual Jews have. So from their Old Testament, because where do these ideas of resurrection start coming from? It's Israel was dead. They were alone. You know, they were beaten up, and I delivered them. I brought them to life. It's always election language. It's always Exodus type language. When you get to Isaiah 24 through 27, the whole little apocalypse of Isaiah, Mike, you know this, you're my thesis reader. I wrote on this in my thesis, but everyone else hasn't heard it. So in Isaiah 24, which 24 through 27 is kind of like what scholars call the chaos conf, you know, is ordering the chaos and bringing you know, ordering the chaos in creation, bringing order. It's seen as victory over the beast, you know, and there's the great celebration on the cosmic mountain and all that. Very, very awesome passage. Too much to get into right now. But an important part of that passage is when this thing goes down, when this great new exodus goes down in the future, the way it's talked about is all the nations are judged. And in the judgment of all the nations, in Isaiah 24, you have a judgment of the host of heaven and the kings of the earth. Mm-hmm. And that when they're – yeah, both. So you have the gods of the nation idea and the king that rules under them. Because it's common in the ancient world. This is not just a Jewish thing. Everybody thinks their god, their kings are – you know, part of the family of the god that's over them, because gods are territorial, you know, they have their territory, they have a, you know, a tribe, a family. And so the king is a son of the god. That's just a common notion. Kings are treated as gods that way. They're venerated like gods for that reason. So they're part of the divine family. It's patriarchal language, you know. So that, so the kings of the earth or the hosts of heaven and the kings of the earth are judged. And then there in Isaiah 40, we have this excuse me, 24, we have this mention that the elders then will see the glory of God. So
Yahweh's elders. That's Isaiah 24, 21. Yeah.
24, 21. And what is that drawing on? The Exodus. When do we have elders beholding God?
Yeah, Exodus 24.
Exodus 24. There it is. And you have the 70, surprise, surprise, ascend the cosmic mountain, and not, and these are human beings. Mm-hmm. So they're going where the gods go. In the Baal epic, Atirat, Baal's consort, invites all the divine council, which in other places in the Baal epic are called the assembly of the stars or the sons of God, or just the assembly of the gods. And they're called there the 70 sons of Atirat. The 70 sons ascend the cosmic mountain to celebrate this, the parting of the sea or the slaying of the sea. You know, this is an archetypical thing going on in the Hebrew Bible, where you have in Exodus 24, the elect ones, the ones who are taken out from under the powers, have now ascended the cosmic mountain, and they now, the 70 of them, surprise, surprise, like the 70 nations, are taking up their function or role as part of what ancient Near Eastern people would have seen only as a role of the divine council. Mm-hmm. And so Isaiah is drawing on that stuff and saying, look, when these hosts of heaven are judged and the kings of the earth are judged, the elders will behold the glory. And there's going to be, and you fast forward to through Isaiah 24 through 27, and what do you find? You find the cosmic mountain, you find a great feast because they ate with the Lord back in Exodus 24. They're eating with them again, but this time all the nations will come to the mountain.
Yeah, I should jump in here just for listeners' sake. This whole, all this talk that you hear about in evangelical, especially prophecy circles, prophecy talk about the marriage supper of the Lamb, that has deep, deep Old Testament roots, and specifically divine council kind of stuff.
That's right.
This whole celebratory supper of the victory of the Lamb. Okay, I hope you're listening, because that's actually what David is just talking about here. But it goes back to this Deuteronomy 4, Exodus 24, all the, you know, this concatenation of ideas that when the gods are judged, okay, think of the Exodus, you know, the gods are judged, you know, this night I will have victory over the gods of Egypt. We have the crossing of the sea. In other words, passing through the waters, untouched by the waters, of course, being the chaos imagery, you know, common throughout the Old Testament.
Right, right.
So we have victory over chaos. Who is like you among the gods? You know, we go to Sinai, we make it to Sinai, and there the 70 ascend to the mountaintop of Sinai and have a meal with the God of Israel. Exodus 24, they saw the God of Israel. I mean, it couldn't be any clearer. And the number is significant, you know, just like you're pointing out. But all of this is backdrop, backstory to this thing, the marriage supper of the Lamb. But when we hear that taught in church, I mean, good grief, it's stripped of just about everything we just talked about.
Yeah. You know, I mean, because
none of that comes along.
Right. Because what we'll do, we're so piecemeal with some of these texts where that you can't just rip these out of this deep narrative context. Mm-hmm. When Paul is drawing on, say, these creature lists, this is part of a much deeper narrative that's going on. And he believes this is an eschatological exodus out from under the powers. You were ethne, you're no longer ethne. You know, you were under the demons, you're not under them anymore. You have one God. Sure, there's
and ultimately,
gods.
Yeah, I know where you're going with this now. And ultimately, mm-hmm. again, we have this creaturely list in 1 Corinthians 15 tied in with the resurrection, because your ultimate deliverance out from under the gods is going to happen at the resurrection. And
bingo.
Oh, by the way, your resurrection is also a key element to you displacing them, you know, the gods of the nations, and replacing
right.
them, becoming the reconstituted, you know, divine council.
Yes,
which is the true God.
Right, sons of God.
Yep.
Even the terms that Paul uses, it's amazing how we can look over these terms and not know all their weighted meaning. When Paul calls his congregation that have received the pneuma, the spirit, or the pnephma, when they receive this, he calls them holy ones.
Yeah.
And he even calls them the assembly of the holy ones, right? The church. That's right out of Psalm 89. Where it's used, who amongst the assembly of the holy ones is like you, Yahweh, the gods.
Yeah, it's divine council term. That's why I just, it's one of the few things that I just really dislike across the board about English translations, you know, using a term like saints.
Yes, it's horrible.
It just, you lose every attachment to the Old Testament imagery when you dump holy ones and use something like saints.
And, you know, it's not a coincidence that every time almost every time Paul uses that language, like in the opening of the letter, you know, to the holy ones in Ephesus or to the holy ones in Corinth, he's attaching it to who follow the Lord. And he'll say things like our God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So they appeal to God as Father, meaning that them being holy ones are already counted as sons of God. They're mm-hmm. already functionally and ontologically, because they have the pnephma, the spirit, they're already sons of God in that sense. And so that's very important. So why, again, back to the 1 Corinthians 15 thing with some of this background, the list follows perfectly that list from Deuteronomy 4. So why that list? Because we saw in Philo, these powers, there's not anything really wrong with them, you know, just don't worship them as gods alone, right? Well, Philo is not an apocalypticist. He's a Platonist. He doesn't think that these powers need to be judged. He doesn't talk about it. He never goes to these texts. But is there another text, though, that would give us a narrative for these powers, these same powers from Deuteronomy that I think Paul is drawing on here, are actually judged in conjunction with a resurrection? And the answer is yes, there is a passage. And it's the one we talk about all the time, and it's Psalm 82.
Mm-hmm.
Because in Psalm 82, that passage talking about the judgment of the gods ends in the last two verses this way. He says, I said, you are gods, sons of the Most High, all of you, but you are dying like men, or you will die like men in the Hebrew. And like one of the rulers in Greek, the archonton, mm-hmm. the same term that Paul uses for the powers.
Right.
Same term.
He Septuagint. Says, you will fall. Yeah.
In the Septuagint. Now, it gets better, Mike. It gets better.
But That's, wait, there's more.
Yeah, but wait, there's more. So God, so whoever this God figure is, In Psalm 82 that's listed at the beginning, that God stands in the assembly of the gods, and in the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. Whoever this is, and by the way, he's getting on to them because he says, how long will you judge unjustly? Which is the whole point. The way Philo talks about it, the way Plato talks about it, look, they know these powers are supposed to rule in justice. They're supposed to copy the rule of the Father of all. They're supposed to rule in justice and law, keep the order of things. But the critique of Psalm 82 is, Psalm 81 in the Septuagint, is that they have not done this. They have not judged rightly. They have judged unjustly. So that's where you get to this critique, and he goes into describing the injustice they've done. But that's where you get the critique at the end that I said, you're gods, sons of the Most High, all of you, but you're dying like men. So see, like men, they're going to die. This is very important. So only men die. The celestial bodies, the celestial gods, they don't die. So they're immortals. They're made of different stuff than man. Man dies. But they are going to die like men. They're like one of the rulers, the Archonton, you will fall. And now the psalmist comes in. And in the Greek, this is very important. In the Greek, you actually have
the term
arise, O God. So whoever this God figure is, in Psalm 82, the psalmist now is speaking to close out the psalm. And he says, The cry of the psalmist is, arise, O God, and judge the earth, because you will obtain inheritance in all the nations, or of all the nations. So the arising here, surprise, surprise, is anasta in Greek.
Yeah, this the is resurrection term.
Exactly. This is the term in the New Testament. Every time it's used, the anastasis or the anastas, this is the term used for resurrection.
That's really interesting, because you could see how Paul, if he has this matrix of ideas in his head, could very easily see a double entendre in that verse. In other words, it's not just the psalmist pleading, you know, logically in Old Testament theology for God to, you know, take back the nations to inherit them. But here, because of the resurrection language, you could see that Paul could be thinking of believers.
Yeah. Well, but he's is specifically this God figure, whoever it is.
Yeah.
Arises.
You could see Christology in there very easily.
I think this is where Paul is getting the narrative in 1 Corinthians 15.
Boy, that would be, yeah. Boy.
This is now. Let me show this to you. Let me.
Where do you
this.
Read? Where do you read that at SBL? That'll be awesome. Go ahead.
Now watch this. This is going to blow your mind when you go to 1 Corinthians 15. But before the passage we're talking about, the nature of resurrection body, he has a little mini apocalyptic narrative of what the resurrection's about. So if you want to know, if you're asking the question, man, what does Paul think is happening with this resurrection thing? What's the resurrection thing all about? He gives you like a little narrative into kind of what's happening in this whole resurrection thing that's going on. Why is the resurrection such a big deal? Is it just some kind of miracle tacked on to the atonement that God received his sacrifice, or is there way more than that? Well, Paul thinks there's way more than that, because he says in this is back in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20 through 28. Listen to this. He says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. Now, it's important here, the language that Paul's using. In 1 Corinthians 15, I have to note this because people look over this. He doesn't always use the term anastasis. He doesn't always use it. When he uses, throughout the passage, he'll use egiro, which is just to rise up or to pull up, yeah. You know, to raise up. But whenever he uses anastasis, it's always like a title of the event. This is the event. It's called the anastasis nekron, or
right. It's the act of the event, the imagery of what happens is egero, raise up,
right?
And but the event itself is referenced as anastasis,
exactly.
Yeah.
So the event, every time Paul does it, if you know Greek or you're looking at the Greek, you can see this. Mm-hmm. When he describes the event, it names the event, it's the resurrection, and then when he uses raising up, it's always that other term. Now that's significant, because if he's drawing on Psalm 82, this means Psalm 82 has been around for a long time, and people have developed a narrative with that where it becomes like this event that people are waiting on. You know, when is this judgment of the gods going to happen? When is God going to rise up and take control? Well, so that's the event itself, the anastasis or the anasta, right? So Paul's is describing this event. He says, verse 21, for as by a man came death, by a man also has come the resurrection of the dead. So you see, he sees this as a big event. So in the first creation, man brought death with him. But in this event, the resurrection of the dead, something has changed, right? So he's like, verse 22, for as in Adam all die, so in Christ all shall be made alive. Now, what we would think of this all being made alive passage is it's like, oh, well, then they'll all get up from the grave too. But we know Paul doesn't think everyone gets a resurrection unto life. And we know that this language of being made alive is used more than just physically getting up out of the grave, because it's used all the time of bringing nations back to life and delivering them from the grave. You know, they're an oppression in Egypt, and I've brought them to life. So it's kind of a restoration language of making things alive. You know, Adam's rule, when he welcomed the evil ones in, it just brought death to everything. But then when Christ's rule comes in, all shall be made alive. So it brings life, right? Because that's how they read those putting the powers over the nations. That's how Plato understands it. That's how Deuteronomy understands it. This is supposed to order the cosmos, right? This is supposed to set it all up, you know, balance everything out, set up the order so that life can go on in God's world. And so this is what's happening with the resurrection, is all are going to be made alive, right? So in verse 23, he says, but in each in his own order, Christ the first fruits. So there's our sowing metaphor that he's going to use in the nature of the resurrection body talk, right? So Christ the first fruits, and then at his coming or at his parousia, those who belong to Christ. Now, if you've studied New Testament before, or if any listeners have studied the parousia before, the coming of Christ, you may have come across this idea that parousia is, you have in the Greco-Roman world, this is very common. It's common in the Semitic world too. Ancient Hebrews would understand this concept as well. When the king goes off to do warfare against the bad guys, and all you guys are staying at home, you don't know what's going on. You don't know how the victory's going. You're at home, you're biting your nails, you know, is our king dead? Has our armies lost? What's the deal? He's gone off to fight for us, you know, and so you're waiting on that runner to come back, right? You're waiting, that's just that ancient thing, you know, if you've studied marathon, you know, they did that in Greece, you know, the runner comes back to tell how the victory's gone. Well, that's when you first see the term gospel in Isaiah. The first time you see the term good news, because this passage is about the good news. It's how he starts the whole thing. It's the gospel. And he's like, when you first see that being used, it's the one, how beautiful are the feet of the one bringing the good news, saying our God reigns, meaning the runner has run back and told us that God has secured the victory. And so the parousia is, the coming is where you'd go out to meet him after he's coming back from conquest. You have the messengers on the wall and they look and he's come. And there's a big parade and pomp and circumstance welcoming the God King back after he's conquered to the city to celebrate. So at his parousia, Paul is saying, all those who belong to Christ as well. So it's picturing Christ in this kind of conquering king imagery of the one who's gone to do battle. And that's how he understands the resurrection. And if you don't believe me, well, let's keep reading. Paul says in verse 24, then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after what? Destroying every rule, every authority and power. And guess what the terms are he uses here? The same terms used from Deuteronomy 4, when Philo reads it, when others read it, of the principalities and powers, which are the celestial bodies who rule over the nations. He's destroying them. He is the conquering king, and upon his resurrection, the resurrection of the dead, is destroying the rulers. Mm-hmm. And what did we have in Psalm 82? At the arising of God, it's at the destruction of the rulers.
That's really interesting because, I mean, there are several things here that and I'm sure people are catching them, at least if they're regular listeners here. But it's another one of these already but not yet kinds of things.
Yes.
In other words, if you're going to talk about the inauguration of the kingdom and you're going to connect that with the resurrection – and even before that, the kingdom being inaugurated by, you know, Jesus sending out, drum roll please, the 70, okay, and
that's right,
giving them power over demonic forces. You know, you have all of these things that inaugurate the kingdom and again, move it along, kickstart it, kick it down the road, keep it moving, you know, inexorably, you know, until the ultimate, you know, consummation of all these things. you know, when we are put over the nations, to him that overcomes, I will put over the nations. To him that overcomes, I will, you know, share the rod of iron that they will rule the nations with. You know, Revelation 2 and 3, where Jesus quotes a messianic psalm and applies it to us. I mean, just this crazy kind of talk.
Well,
it's very consistent.
Watch what Paul does with this, though, because his whole destroying every rule and power, he has something in mind that he's drawing on. He says in verse 25, for he, Christ, must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Mm-hmm. So what passage is he drawing on here? The enemies under his feet. This is Psalm 110, mm-hmm. putting the enemies under his feet. Yep. Now, the question then becomes, well, you know, David, is this really drawing on Psalm 82? I mean, do you have any example in early Judaism where that actually happens, where people are using Psalm 82 to talk about the judgment of the gods and all that? Is that really what he's talking about? Yes, we do. Surprise, surprise. Thanks to Qumran. When we dig up Qumran, we found this text, 11Q Melchizedek, about Melchizedek, and it uses Psalm 82 in the same way, and even makes the connection. This is Melchizedek from Psalm 110. These connections connect
the two passages. Yeah.
Exactly. It's connecting Psalm 110, the Melchizedek figure, to the person who comes in Psalm 82. I'll read the passage from 11Q Melchizedek. This is from Qumran. It says, it's the time of the year of grace of Melchizedek and of his armies, the nation of the holy ones of God. Surprise, surprise here. Of the rule of judgment. As it is written about him in the songs of David, who said, Psalm 82. It's interesting, he calls it a Psalm of David. In the Hebrew canon, it's a Psalm of Asaph.
Interesting.
But who said, Psalm 82:1, quote, God will stand in the assembly of the gods, in the midst of the gods he judges. And about him, Melchizedek, he said, from Psalm 7:8-9, and above it, to the heights, return, God will judge the peoples. So this judgment figure is this Melchizedek figure, this redeemer figure who comes and does it. It's not Yahweh himself. It's Melchizedek who's the agent of Yahweh going and destroying the powers and inheriting or judging the peoples. He says, as for what he said, Psalm 82:2, how long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? And then the interpreter says, its interpretation concerns Belial and the spirits of his lot. So it's the allotted
his allotment, spirits. Yeah.
There's the allotment language. He says, who turning aside from the commandments of God to commit evil, but Melchizedek, who will carry out the vengeance of God's judgments. And on that day, he will free them from the hand of Belial and from the hand of all the spirits of his lot. Mm-hmm. So already they're reading this as an eschatological event. Yeah. Where you have the Redeemer figure coming with his holy ones to judge the gods and to redeem them from those evil allotment, using Psalm 82 in the same way.
Yeah, and so for listeners, you know, this is a pre-Christian text, you know, and so Paul comes along and using the same language, you know, fixes this to what happened on the cross, you know, to the event of the cross and the resurrection. And of course, the inauguration of the kingdom, you know, that we read about in the New Testament. You know what else the victory imagery reminds me of is Psalm 68.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because and for those who have read Unseen Realm, you know, I talk about Psalm 68, Mount of Bashan, of course, and then you get this connection, of course, Mount Bashan. Well, there's only one mountain in the region of Bashan, way up north there, and that was Hermon.
Right.
You know,
right.
And you get the whole Watchers thing going on, and. You know, so there you have plural agents to the one, you know, big bad guy of the realm, you know, the gateways to the netherworld, mm-hmm. Ashtaroth and Edrai and the Lord of the Dead. And I mean, all of these things connect together. And that's the passage, of course, Paul quotes about Christ ascending, you know, the resurrection, and then the coming of the Spirit, you know, and the church, the church who against whom the gates of hell will not be able to withstand. You know, they're the ones that in connection with this event, they get the pastors and the, you know, the prophets and the, you know, the apostles and the teachers and the whole grocery list there. I mean,
right.
All of these points, again, I'm hoping listeners catch this. Basically, nothing that David has talked about today works in isolation from any of the other points
that's right.
David has brought up today.
That's right.
They're all interconnected. It is a matrix of ideas.
That's right. It's an ongoing narrative, and it's an expectation that this narrative has a climax in the resurrection. That's how they're understanding it. And by the way, that this 11Q Melchizedek text, it goes on immediately in the next line and says that to his aid, to Melchizedek's aid, shall come all the gods of justice. And so these there's good gods, whoever they are coming to aid Melchizedek in the destruction of Belial and the other spirits to redeem the people. So there's already divine figures involved in this.
Are you looking at the Hebrew text for the gods of justice there? I'm wondering what the word justice is. I could look at it. You could continue.
Yeah, I have the diglot here.
Okay.
I need to make this point. He says, there's a bunch of lacunas here. There's a mention of the sons of God. Like, lacunas are spaces where we don't have text. And so there's these spaces here we don't have text. It's like who, blank, 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 all the sons of God, blank, blank, this, blank, blank. And then you have a mention of what I just mentioned earlier with Isaiah. The author says, is the day of peace about which he said, and then there's a blank, through Isaiah the prophet, who said, Isaiah 52:7, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of the messenger who announces peace, the messenger of good news who announces salvation, saying to Zion, your God reigns. This is the idea. So the narrative is already there in their minds, and hundreds of years before Jesus, we have this is developed for a while. Psalm 82 is being used in an eschatological way. So you have this redeemer figure who goes and judges the gods. He's going to save the people from the hands of Belial and the spirits of his lot. He's going to deliver them. In Paul's case, the rulers, the principalities, the powers. And as a result, they are going to be destroyed. And that's the good news that's announced. Is that this is happening. This is the good news. It's salvation. It's new exodus. We're being delivered out from under the powers. You know, the powers are being destroyed. That's the narrative that Paul is drawing on. This is what's happening in Christ's resurrection. This isn't just like, hey, good job on the cross. You can come to heaven now and it's all done. It's like, no, you're ascending into heaven and cosmic warfare is going down. You are destroying the principalities and powers, and as a result, others are going to join him at his coming, those who belong to Christ. So Christ, whatever has happened to Christ then in his resurrection will also happen to his. And this is the point with when he actually gets into the nature of the resurrection body in verse 35 through 50 there that we read. And this is why he draws his list from Deuteronomy 4 instead, because at this resurrection, it's being seen as this new exodus, this new election. It's out from under the powers. When you go to die, the seed goes in the ground. It does not come out the same thing. The earthly body is made of flesh. You've talked about this in the previous podcast. Mm-hmm. And then the heavenly body is of glory. Now, we see another connection with this language from Deuteronomy 4. You remember me mentioning that Deuteronomy 4 talks about the likeness, right? Mm-hmm. Well, we see that, and you talked about this in your podcast, and I was a little bit frustrated you already talked about it because I wanted to mention it, but you beat me to it, is the language from Ezekiel 1. Mm-hmm. When you see the heavenly one, the glory of Yahweh, it says he's in the likeness of a human being.
Yeah.
And it's the same term, the omioma in Greek. It's the same term that's being used in Deuteronomy 4. And it's the same term used in Philippians. So Paul's thinking in this general idea that it is the likeness of a human form, but it is not the same stuff. Mm-hmm. It is celestial. It is like the gods. That's what the body is like. And we already have precedent for this in passages, of course, like Daniel 12, where the resurrection, it's at the arising of Michael, surprise, surprise. And in the Greek, it's the same Anasta. And they're reading, and many commentators say Daniel 12 is reading Psalm 82's tradition of the arising and the conquering of the foes. Because Daniel 8, you have that falling language that Psalm 82 uses of the stars, or that are the hosts of heaven. Mm-hmm. And then you have the mention of those princes of heaven who are cosmically fighting in the heavens against Israel's messenger, against the messenger that comes, and against Michael, Israel's chief prince. So when that chief heavenly figure defeats the other princes and arises, that's in Daniel 12 when the resurrection takes place. Once Michael has arisen victorious, so too the resurrection happens, and you all shine as the stars of heaven.
You know what's really interesting about this, and again, we're not, well, I'll just say it this way. If you think, okay, in all of this rising Michael, you know, talk, if listeners sort of just try, at least, you know, for this moment, to not think of their own resurrection, in other words, to not think of the end times, you know, the ultimate consummation, right, of this. If you think about Jesus, you know where else you see this combination? You see it in Revelation 12.
That's,
okay, the war in heaven passage. And, you know, I've spent a lot of commentary, you know, on like, look, again, this has nothing to do with some primeval rebellion that comes from Milton's Paradise Lost or the 19th century, the gap theory, or all this kind of stuff. If you look at the passage, this war in heaven happens in conjunction with, again, I'm not alone here, but my view that you have the birth, you have astral signage of the birth of the Messiah, you have the war in heaven, and then you also have him being caught up. Okay.
Yep.
You have the resurrection language. And so it would be another indicator that all of this, the kingdom, the resurrection, the defeat again of the powers, has already been launched. Okay, it's already in motion. It's already happening.
Right.
It's not something completely, you know, wait until the end. It's right now. So again, you have this whole matrix of ideas. And the reason there's a specific reason I'm bringing this up, because a number of our listeners, especially those who were, you know, touched in some way by the Fern and Audrey episode and their ministry to, you know, survivors of ritual trauma, a lot of which involves very bad theological messaging. A lot of those people are frankly enslaved by thoughts of being owned by Satan, and, you know, they can't have victory. You know, they're God hates them because of what happened to them. All this kind of stuff, and it's all tied into this notion that they are abandoned and that they there's no sort of recourse to defeat, you know, the powers. You know, you're just going to die like you are, and all this kind of stuff. It's just a lot of bad thinking. And one of the reasons why, you know, that Fern and Audrey have found the Divine Council stuff so helpful is because it focuses on the enactment of the already present victory, and another way of saying that is the already present defeat of the powers. So here we go again. It's the same, again, set of ideas drawing, and here we are starting in 1 Corinthians 15, you wind up back in Deuteronomy, and you get the whole matrix of ideas again.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to point that out.
Yeah, and so I guess to wrap up this nature of the body thing, when we go back to the original passage we're talking about, this 1 Corinthians 15 passage, the whole question in verse 35 is, how are the dead raised? What kind of body do they come? Mm-hmm. So it's, what kind of bodies are these? And you talked about that in your previous podcast. But the important part here is those fleshly creatures are the ones from Deuteronomy 4 that are ruled over by the celestial creatures. And so, yeah, this is not just a question of the nature and the kind of stuff the body's made out of. This is also talking about their actual roles.
Mm-hmm.
Because these fleshly creatures, the humans, animals, birds, fish, that's all the first order from Deuteronomy 4. And then the next order is the glorious ones, the sun, moon, and other stars.
Do you realize, I mean, I know you do, but folks, you got to listen to this. Because what David's describing is the return to the correct Edenic relationship, where the sons of God, okay, the family of God, instead of worshiping the creature, being dominated by other gods, everything is corrected. It is brought back into proper order in this consummated new earth, you know, this eternal existence, you know, with us ruling over the nations. There's a global Eden, all this, you know, this concatenation of ideas again. I'll try not to interrupt you again, but I mean, it's like that. That's just so cool.
It's amazing, really, because there's a lot of scholars who, unfortunately, I think, get this wrong. And I want to be humble because, you know, I'm still a young guy in all this. But there's this, when we're so quick to rush to apologetic answers for the resurrection, like, well, let me prove it to you. Here's 1 Corinthians 15 right here. You know, and you'll miss all of the Jewish background to this, all of the Old Testament background to this. This is an incredibly carefully put together passage. And this is where it connects with the Abrahamic promise thing. Because the Abrahamic promise thing that we talked about in my previous interview, and my article's finally come out after all this time. It's finally in print. It's in libraries of major that has good biblical studies resources, Journal for Study of Paul and His Letters, volume 5.2. You can go buy it on their website if you'd like. It's $15. I don't get a dime, so don't think I'm getting money out of this. You know,
the publisher makes sure of that.
Yeah, the publisher makes sure I'm not getting nothing out of that. But it's a journal. I don't blame them. So the point is, I've talked about this before, that this is how early Jews are understanding the promise to Abraham in the end, is that the promise to Abraham in the end is that his seed would become like the stars. That is how they understand this. And in the Abrahamic promise, the promise, the Evangelia, is close to what we understand as Evangelion, the good news or gospel. When Paul says this in Galatians, you know, the gospel was preached to Abraham when he was told that the nations would be blessed by his seed, right? That was the gospel. Mm-hmm. And this, again, 1 Corinthians 15 is about the gospel. And when we don't read this in its proper narrative context, you're not going to understand the nature of the body passage, because already it's framed. Paul even gives us like a little parentheses to frame this whole discussion in, and it's the kingdom of God. That's the language that he's drawing on. From in the 2028 passage where he narrates to you what's happening in the resurrection, he says, he must deliver the kingdom to God after destroying the powers, right? And so then God will be all in all once it's all done and everything's in subjection to him.
And look, Galatians 3, the gospel preached beforehand to Abraham. What does he say? He quotes the covenant, and you shall all nations be blessed.
Exactly. You're going to be set free from these powers. Yeah. It's freedom. It's election. It's the seed of Abraham. You're chosen out from the nations. It's happening on a cosmic scale. It's cosmic election. It's cosmic exodus. This is a huge event. The resurrection that he's talking about, the event, he's getting from that Psalm 82 Deuteronomy worldview. That's how he understands it, is that no longer – you're not just nations anymore, because if you're nations, you're under the demons. You're still eating with the demons. You're not eating this great supper when we get together with the one God and one Lord. And how does he talk about that? If he's drawing on the Exodus, we should see it if that's what he's talking about. And that's exactly what you see in 1 Corinthians 10, right smack in the middle of this whole long section on idolatry. He says, hey, it was our fathers that were baptized into Moses in the cloud and the fire. And they ate the spiritual food and drank from the same spiritual drink from the rock which followed them, which was Christ. He's like, so Paul is already narrating their whole experience of baptism, receipt of the Spirit, as going down into the waters, going through the waters, coming out the other side in Exodus, death, raised to walk in newness of life. You see the same stuff in Romans, you see the same stuff in Colossians, transferred from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of his beloved son. This is the big narrative. this happens. The new Exodus, you go into baptism unto death, and you're raised to newness of life. Yeah, you're no longer under the powers.
Look at the baptism in imagery. Powers. Yeah.
It's very important.
I mean, this just you know, leaks into all sorts of New Testament theological elements.
But the important part is lots of scholars have missed this language of saying, well, Paul doesn't think they're actually going to become celestial bodies. Well, yes, he does, because we have a misunderstanding of what Paul means by that. Mm-hmm. Normally, when apologists are saying, no, he's not saying they become stars. It's he understands them to be the gods. These are the powers from Deuteronomy. These are the ones that have dominion and authority. He even uses the language, like we've pointed out.
Yeah, they're going to become divine. Yeah.
Yes, this is a deification passage. Resurrection is not just, hey, you get back up and you got the, look, another little human body just like you had before. No, it is a different thing. And this is why, and if you listen carefully, you can hear the language in when he's describing the polarization. There's a good book on polarity and change in 1 Corinthians by Asher about this, like where he's like, so too is it with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. These are terms used by Philo and other Jews to describe the powers. They're imperishable. The Stoics use that language to talk about the pneumatic beings, the spirit beings. They're right. Imperishable.
Whatever that body is made of, it's made of stuff that's imperishable, right. just like those beings who are imperishable.
And it's sown in dishonor. So here's the sowing metaphor coming back. The seed, it's sown in dishonor. So you put the seed in the ground, it dies, mm-hmm. and it's raised in glory. Glory is the language he's used glory, for these celestial creatures. They are of glory. And what a lot of English translations will mess up is in verse 40. But where he says, when he splits the celestial and the earthly, you know, and he says there are celestial bodies and there's terrestrial bodies, but the glory of the celestial is one and of the earthly is another, is how it should read. But they always add another glory in there. They say, but the glory of the heavenly is of one kind and mm-hmm. the glory of the earthly is another. But he doesn't use the term glory for the earthly.
Right, right.
He never does. He says the glory of the celestial is of one kind and of the earthly is another.
Yeah, it's a good example of an English translator trying to help and messing
exactly.
it up. Yeah.
They mess it up. The same with the whole promise to Abraham thing. When people try to interpret that, they add the term numerous in there. They're like, and so numerous shall your seed be. Even though he doesn't ever say numerous, he says, so shall your seed be, like the stars. So this is where this is coming from, I think. This is the climax of the promise, because in the resurrection, out of Daniel 12, and a host of other traditions in Second Temple period. You can find it in 1 Enoch 104, 2 through 6. You can find it in 2 Baruch 51, 1 through 12. You can find it in 4th Ezra 797. You can find it in Testament of Moses, on and on. I could an important one you can look up later is 4 Maccabees 17, 5 through 6, that retells the resurrection of the sons, of the hope for the resurrection of the sons from 2 Maccabees 7. It retells the story and climaxes with how august is this faithful mother. She's like the moon. She outshines the moon, and your sons are like stars, and truly are they sons of Abraham. So it's so obvious. This is how the Jews interpret apocalyptically, like the climax of this narrative, the promise of Abraham. They become like the stars. And what was the promise? The seed. It's the seed. And this is exactly why Paul is using the metaphor here. This is because in his mind is this promise of becoming like the stars in the resurrection. And he understands that as the seed of Abraham. And so that seed of the new pnephma, the seed of the spirit, comes in, it's planted, and that sucker dies, and what comes out is the spiritual body. It is the resurrection, and the promise is fulfilled, and they take up the dominion. And if you think, well, what? This is all there in 1 Corinthians? Well, if you go back to 1 Corinthians 6, this is the giveaway. In 1 Corinthians 6, he uses the same language that connects all these dots from this kind of matrix of text that we're talking about. If you remember the passage, he says, when one of you has a grievance against another, does he dare go to law before the unrighteous instead of the holy ones? Or do you know that the holy ones will judge the cosmos? Mm-hmm. And the language is the exact same language of judging krinite or krinusin that's from Psalm 82. Mm-hmm. The judgment is connected to the inheritance. The inheritance language of the nations is from Abrahamic promise.
Yep. And then judging and the angels in the next line.
And in the very next line. And if the cosmos is to be judged by you, are you incompetent to try trivial cases? Do you not know that we are to judge angels? So this is, he's already drawing on this narrative, on this understanding, long before you get to 1 Corinthians 15. So it should, by that time, if we know these texts, if we know this complex of thinking, it should become obvious. But see, what started out as, man, we're just getting the background text wrong, develops into, it's not just the background text we're getting wrong, it's when we get that background text wrong, we're not seeing the whole narrative that Paul's drawing on.
Right.
And how he actually understands what is taking place in the resurrection. And the last thing I'll say about that is, well, David, what about the Adam stuff? Because he says the first Adam and the last Adam, isn't that from Genesis? Well, if you know your Old Testament like a Jew knows is, you know Adam isn't only about Genesis 1 and 2. Adam and the sons of Adam go all the way up into Genesis 11. So when you're thinking Adam as a Jew, you're elected out from under those guys. You know, all those nations, they're the sons of Adam. We're not part of them anymore. We're not part of the nations anymore. We're a whole nother thing. We're a kingdom of priests. They're all the sons of Adam. They're all the ones that have gone astray. We're the ones that worship the true God. So they are, from a Jewish perspective, you could say, well, all those nations, they're still in Adam in that sense. They're still the ethne. They're still divided amongst the gods.
Yeah, but believers are united to the new Adam. The second right. Adam, you know, in again, back to a global Eden, everything is brought back full circle and corrected and made as it should have been.
Mm-hmm. And he's using Adam as a extremely powerful metaphor because he's playing on the dust language from Genesis 2 of being made from the dust.
Yeah.
But what is he talking about? He's talking about the seed. That old humanity that used to be enslaved to the powers, when that goes in the ground, once it's been planted from heaven, because you're of heaven, you're from the man of heaven, which is the life-giving spirit. Yeah. So when he's giving us that spirit that's life-giving, that's the seed. And when that old humanity goes back to the dust, to dust you will return, death, right? That's the whole issue is death. They go down and die, the seed's planted, and what comes out the other side? This is the celestial. This is a whole new humanity.
Yeah, who would your
divine humanity?
Who would you rather be united to, the first Adam or the second one?
Right. And
it's kind of an obvious answer.
But Paul's rhetoric is so brilliant here. I mean, that connecting the seed to the man of dust, to all the nations, to the deliverance out from under the powers. This is all his big, epic, apocalyptic narrative of the resurrection. It's so much bigger than just getting up out of the grave.
Wow. Well, just to wrap up here, I'm not going to give a name here, but, and you might know who it is, but don't spill the beans here, but just an Old Testament scholar and friend who I can just remember several years ago, getting into a little discussion about divine counsel, and what he actually said was, "I don't really know how any of that what any of that has to do with the New Testament." I don't know if you remember that.
Oh well,
but
I'm gonna keep the guilty parties from being revealed.
Boy, it just sure be warmed and filled, you know.
You know, for their sake, look, and you know, Mike, it's really sad because there a lot of New Testament scholars, and I don't blame them. I mean, there is just droves and droves and droves of literature being published all the time, and New Testament scholars are up to their ears. I mean,
that's real.
You know, it's like they just can't. And some of them in their early education, it didn't do a lot of ancient Near Eastern studies. You know, they didn't do a lot of contextual study of the Old Testament. So they miss some of that images and some of the language that frames the whole stinking meta narrative. Yeah. And so when you miss those key parts, like early on, and you're trying to piece together these narratives in their original context, you're not actually reading the whole context.
Yeah. Well, thanks for that. I mean, that was great.
That was a long episode here.
Well, yeah, it was, but that just has so much good stuff in it. Again, just this matrix of ideas, and that's what I'm hoping people see, that these things that we talk about, you know, divine counsel stuff, it's not just in isolation. These aren't just sort of arcane observations of trivial curiosities. I mean, this stuff filters down into New Testament theology in really, really significant ways. So I'm glad you were able to come back on and give us the gist of the paper. And I can hardly wait for the Q&A at SBL. In a good way, because I'm just going to be curious, because it's basically going to be a group of New Testament people.
Yep.
I'm willing to bet 90% of the scholars in that room will just be kind of looking around like, what in the world just hit us? You know, like they just won't have the framework. But it's always interesting to see what surfaces in the Q&A and who's got the framework and who doesn't, and you know, what you need to work on. It's actually good direction, you know, for what needs to be worked on.
Yep. Yep.
Well, I'm curious, when you talk to other scholars about the framework, what kind of reaction do you get? Do they seem open to it, or do they just shut you down, or do they go back and process it and come back? I mean,
yeah.
What's the feedback you get?
Yeah, that's a great question. I'll give you an example. The 2 weeks ago when I gave the paper at the regional SBL, there is about, 15 people in the room. It's a small room. And that I asked when I was done with the paper, and the chair of the session was like, okay, open for questions and answers, and it was just kind of like everyone's mouth is kind of like, what just happened? and looking at me like, what? And I'm like, so I've convinced all of you, and I got a lot of nods like, well, yeah, I mean, they didn't know what to say.
Right.
And I got a couple of good questions toward the end. And some scholars who are really open to it, some young scholars that were really open to it. I know Michael Thompson from Erdmann's had come in and listened to my paper, and from Erdmann's Publishing, and he's been interested and he's been following my work, and I think he's tracking with me now. I've had to explain some of this stuff to him, but so some of them are catching on to this, and I think. Some of them, like Mike says, are just deer in a headlights type deal. But I tell you what, that I mentioned him before, but Matthew Thiessen, who was teaching at St. Louis University, who's now moving to McMaster, in his book, Paul and the Gentile Problem, he nails it with the Abrahamic promise. We basically say the same thing. So I have all the divine counsel background in mind. So, but he gets the New Testament appropriation of the promise right, and he connects it. He even connects it to the resurrection. And he cites my article a couple times in there. So he gets
it. You know what I think is going to happen?
Get it? I think.
Well, I think the newer generation, let's just say the past 10, 15, 20 years of New Testament scholars, I think this is fair to say, have been forced to do more work in Second Temple material.
Yeah.
And on the one hand, that's great, but it only gets you halfway. So they run into the matrix of ideas, but they can't necessarily ask the question, okay, well, where did the Second Temple Jews, what were they thinking? Why were they looking at this passage this way? I mean, they can see that the New Testament is part of that whole mix, but it doesn't really, it just puts them in touch with people living at the same time as the New Testament writers, and everybody's sort of, dealing with, again, the same set of ideas, and New Testament is often a little bit different because of Christology and Jesus and all that. But it doesn't take them back into, okay, why would they think of it this way? And so somebody like you, who has more of the Old Testament background under their belt, I think will be actually able to contribute to solving that problem, or at least that might be too optimistic of a word. At least,
I wouldn't use that word.
At least contributing to, okay, here's why they're looking at this right. way. But a lot of it for decades and decades, if you're going to be a New Testament scholar, what you did was you learned your languages really well, and you did New Testament, and then you did Greco-Roman stuff. Well, again, in the last few decades, and N.T. Wright has had a big role to play in this because of his insistence, really, of taking New Testament material in its Second Temple context. So that has really ramped up the insistence in doctoral programs and in New Testament scholarship generally. To situate what we're thinking, not just in Greco-Roman stuff, but to go back to the Second Temple Jewish material. But again, they only make half the trip because that material is informed by, lo and behold, the Old Testament. And the Old Testament is informed by its wider ancient Near Eastern context. So they get halfway, but they're further than they were.
Right.
They're tracking on the right trajectories. And so I think your generation, David, and as more of this effort to take an original context for the material at each sort of stage, of the transmission of ideas, the flow right. of ideas, to take the original context seriously at each stage, I think you and others like you will play a role in taking it back one more step. To where it needs to go. And so that's my hope. I mean, that people who would bother to read Unseen World, if they read the footnotes, they will notice that I'm talking about Second Temple stuff and ancient Near Eastern stuff and basically saying it all needs to get talked about.
Yeah,
but that's not the norm. Okay, that has not been the norm, but it is starting to shift.
Well, just a word of encouragement on my end. I mean, I come from small biblical studies college, Criswell College in Dallas, and we had a great Septuagint seminar a few years ago with Kevin Wersler, my thesis reader that you're on the committee with, and in that class we talked a lot about, and I think some students are getting interested in seeing, like, oh man, there's lots of interesting developments when you get to Septuagint and how Greeks are translating these ancient Hebrew ideas into the Hellenistic culture. And I think the trajectory thing is really important here, that people are getting, that younger guys are getting interested in, is like, well, man, maybe Septuagint's way more important than I thought it was. And maybe we need to look at how these Greek scriptures are receiving the Old Testament and how they're translating it into language that makes sense in the Hellenistic world. Mm-hmm. And we have to do that and see that this is all coming through those ancient Semitic trajectories into the Greek world, and not try to do Greek world back, mm-hmm. because it's more of a trying to, what we see in Septuagint and in Paul in particular is trying to communicate these hard, deep-seated and deep-rooted, no pun intended, deep-rooted Old Testament tradition and Jewish tradition, and how do we express this in its Hellenistic world?
It used to be, I can remember 30 years ago, when the first time I was contemplating, I'm going to have to go through doctoral work here, but I remember picking up catalogs, and for New Testament programs, what you had to do were things like, you had to be able – They wanted to basically try to make you a sight reader. You had to have translated it at least once through the entire New Testament. You had to, take advanced Greek grammar. You had to be good at textual criticism. In other words, it was all New Testament focused. And the only thing you really did outside was you might get a little exposure to rabbinics, which is actually post-New Testament.
Right, right.
Okay, but you didn't have any emphasis on Second Temple, Jewish material. And so, again, I think this is something that we can really thank N.T. Wright for, because he's had such an impact and influence. And one of the reasons he did is he's waving the flag out there saying, hey, there's this whole 400 years of material here that you're kind of skipping, you know, that preceded the New Testament, that has ties back into the old. So why are we looking at just the New Testament and rabbinic material, you know, the later material? It's really quite a different orientation, and it's one of the reasons why there's been a shift in scholarship to what, you know, as I would put it, I think that's what has to happen. Things have to be contextualized in what came before and what was going on during and before. And if you don't do that, you are going to miss connections. You're going to miss a lot of things.
Yeah, I think our listeners have a front row seat to this change, you know, through you, Mike, and David. And it's interesting to watch as a layman this kind of shift in more knowledge is power. So it's logical. Why would you not learn more and go further back and get a bigger picture of what you're learning?
Yeah,
common sense. I mean, why would you not do that?
Why would you not want to have floating around in your head what was floating around in Paul's? Okay, or Peter's or Jude's, you know, because we've talked about Enoch. I mean, they were very familiar with Enochian, you know, the Enochian corpus, the Enochian material. Why not read it? Because it's going to help you understand, now I know why he's doing this over here and he's connecting this to that because I'm familiar with that material.
All right, David, we appreciate that. I look forward to meeting you at SBL in San Antonio this year. And is there anything you would like to mention as far as your blog or paper or how the listeners can get a hold of you, anything like that?
Yeah, sure. That you can contact me via email at dburnett51@yahoo.com. That's dburnett51@yahoo.com. The 1 Corinthians 15 paper is not ready yet for publication. In November, once I get feedback from the scholars at the seminar, then it'll be publish worthy. You can also, I have a blog that I sometimes use. I have a current series going right now at just dburnett.com. So those are ways to get in touch with me if you'd like. And the copy of my article from the last interview, if you're interested in it, just you can email me at that email.
Okay, well, great. And I'll put a link to that email on the website as well. And David, we appreciate it. Thanks, Ben.
Hey, thanks a lot, Trey. And thanks, Mike.
Yep, thanks a lot, David.
We're all right, Mike. That was a good one.
Yeah, a lot of good stuff.
Absolutely. So tell me about the study guides. They're finally available.
Yeah, and that is the right word, finally. For those who maybe missed it on the blog or don't follow the blog, you should follow the blog, drmsh.com. Or follow me on Twitter, you know, at MS Heiser. The study guide for Unseen Realm, as far as the Q&A companion, it's a companion book written by Doug Van Dorn, set in question and answer format that tracks through the ideas presented in Unseen Realm. That is finally available in print. Okay, so you can actually get a print copy of that. You can go on Amazon, you'll find it, just put in Unseen Realm Companion or just Unseen Realm and scroll down through the things that Amazon will return to you. So that's available in print, and so is the Leader's Guide for Small Groups for Supernatural. Again, Supernatural is the little version, the light version of Unseen Realm, and that has had, you know, a digital, you know, Leader's Guide, but now that as well is finally available in print. So you can find them on Amazon. You could go up to, again, my website, drmsh.com, and search for them there. But Amazon's probably the quicker trip.
Do you know the difference of the two? I mean, could you speak on...
Yeah. I mean, they don't really look anything like each other. I mean, they deliberately designed the covers to correspond to the respective covers of the books. So the companion for Unseen Realm will look a lot like the Unseen Realm cover, you know, the same colors, that sort of aqua greenish kind of thing. And then the other one is that red color. But the companion for Unseen Realm is like a catechism. It's questions with answers, and then the answers have footnotes and scripture references to them. Basically, it distills the content of Unseen Realm into sort of a, you know, pithy Q&A kind of format. And then the Leader's Guide for Supernatural, again, that we imagine people would use in small groups, but you know, people could use it for self-study too. That has just like summaries content summaries of sections of the book. There, I think, I'm trying to remember how many chapters there are in Supernatural, the little one. I think it's 16, something like that. And I think the Leader's Guide has either 6 or 8 chapters. So what each chapter is a summary of a few chapters in Supernatural. And then it has questions, you know, following that, that people could use to facilitate small groups. So they don't really look, you know, internally or externally with the cover like each other, but they are meant to correspond to the other books in different ways.
All right. And then also you're giving, have a giveaway.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, there's still, as of today anyway, there's still, I think it'll extend through the weekend. I think it will extend through the weekend, but I'm giving away a copy of the translation of First Enoch, the Book of Enoch, that I recommend. And this giveaway has been going for a while on the blog. Amazon lets you run them for 7 days, and I think the 7th day will go through the weekend. If not, you know, I'm planning to do other giveaways, but it's random. I don't determine who the winner is. You can get the link on my website, drmsh.com. I also put it out on Twitter. And I also put it on Facebook in the last day or two, again, just about the deadline for that. So take a look up there, and all you got to do is click through a link and follow my Amazon page, and then it'll tell you if you want or not. But I'm going to do more of these, so if you don't get in on this one, you know, follow the blog, follow me on Twitter, and you'll get a heads up, you know, about other giveaways to other books.
Sweet. Good deal. And you've got some more details about your L.A. trip.
Yeah, on April 23rd, I'm going to be in, what is it called now? San Juan Capistrano. Like, I didn't even know there was such a place. San Juan Capistrano. It's about an hour from Los Angeles proper. I think it's, you know, still in Orange County. I'm not quite sure. But April 23rd, I'm going to be there the whole day. It's an Unseen Realm event, so we'll have about 4 hours of talking about, you know, Unseen Realm topics. We'll probably have at least an hour and a half of Q&A. And, you know, if people want books signed, you know, we'll do that. So this, I think, is the 9th. This will be the 9th Unseen Realm event. But people can go up to drmsh.com/events, and you will see a link to the event on April 23rd. So if you're in that area, you know, show up. I do have to say that the space that they're, you know, giving for this event is small. I've been told that only 50 people can fit in the room. So it's not a whole lot of seating. So you're going to need to get there early. The doors will open at 8:30 in the morning. The actual event will start at 9 and go till about 3. So in view of the space accommodations, you want to take that into consideration and be there at the beginning. So with that caveat, hope to see you there.
Well, maybe we can pack it and maybe if it gets big enough, we can move to the cafeteria or something.
Yeah.
Or the gymnasium.
Yeah, it's in a Christian school there, so they probably have, you know, a bigger area. But, you know, I haven't been there, so I don't know for sure. But just go up to drmsh.com/events. You click on the event, you'll get the address and all the details.
All right, that sounds good. All right, Mike. Well, next week we're going to do our 11th Q&A, and then after that we'll do another Q&A. So we're going to double down on our questions and answers to try to chip away and make some headway with our questions. I've been getting a lot more questions here lately, so we really want to try to make a dent in all of our questions. So look forward to that next week. Mike, is there anything else you would like to add to the show?
No, I think that's it. I think we're all done.
All right. Well, I just want to say thank you to David Burnett for the interview, and thank everybody for listening to the Naked Bible Podcast. God bless.
Thanks for listening to the Naked Bible Podcast. To support this podcast, visit www.nakedbibleblog.com. To learn more about Dr. Heiser's other websites and blogs, go to www.drmsh.com.